as much as many have taken in hand to set forth in order a declaration of those things which are most surely believed among us, even as they delivered them unto us, which from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word, it seemed good to me also, having had perfect understanding of all things from the very first, to write unto thee in order, O excellent Theophilus, that thou mightest know the certainty of those things wherein thou hast been instructed. Country. My childhood and youth were spent in northern British Columbia, hunting in the woods and fishing in the streams. I saw the Creator in the grandeur of the mountains and heard Him speak to me as the wind blew gently through the tall fir trees. Little did I know that my life would soon begin to be affected by a ministry which God had sent into this generation. Hello, I'm Ed Biscoe. It was my privilege to be an eyewitness of many of the events which took place in the life and ministry of Reverend William Branham. I want to share some of these experiences with you that you might know the certainty with which we speak and of these things of which I am a witness. I was 14 years old when my mother and father were journeying down to southern British Columbia, having moved from the north where we once had lived. It was a distance of about 1,000 to 1,500 miles by road. And they stopped in a small city called Vernon, B.C. There were some special meetings taking place at that time. That was in 1949. Well, I had attended many meetings when I was a child, and so this wasn't unusual to me. But what I was surprised at was the crowds of people. There were between 8,000, 10,000 people gathered each night for 10 days. I was very, very surprised, not only at the crowds, but at the type of ministry. And I was soon to find out that these were special meetings which were being conducted by Reverend William Branham, who we know now as Brother William Branham. His manager, who would come out on the platform and take the preliminary part of the service, would explain to the people the kind of ministry that he had. The thing that was of particular interest to me was the fact that this gift had been ministered to him by an angel. And I had heard of angels as a child in Sunday school, hearing it over the pulpit in church, but had never seen a man with my eyes who had actually talked with an angel. So that gripped my young heart. I was with some other young people, and night after night, Brother Branham would come out on the platform, and they would explain the gift that God had given to him, and he would take the people by the hand. Then he was able to tell them what their diseases were. Each night it seemed to be absolutely accurate each time. So about three nights into the meetings, I decided to leave all my friends, and I wanted to get up real close. I was hoping to see something outstanding. I was about the third row from the front. I got a seat right on the aisle. That night, they introduced Brother Branham once again and explained the gift, explained how the angel of the Lord had come to him.
One night I was praying in my room, and when I raised up, I noticed there was a light on the floor. And looking around to see where it come from, it was coming from above. The pillar of fire was hanging just above. It was throwing the light on the floor. I heard someone walking. I looked, coming through the room, coming into this light came a man. And human figure, he'd be about 200 pounds of weight. He had dark hair to his shoulder, an olive complexion. He was barefooted. Of course, I was frightened. And he said to me, "Fear not." And as soon as I heard that voice, I knew it was the same voice that had always spoke to me, but the first time I'd ever seen him in human form. And he said, "I am sent from the presence of God to tell you that you're to pray for sick people. Great signs and wonders will be following your ministry, and you'll be praying for kings and monarchs and so forth." Well, I told him I was a poor man. I had no education. I would not be able to do this job. He said, "As Moses was given two signs of confirmation of his ministry, that I would be given two signs. One would be the praying for the sick, the miracles, and the other would be, you know, the very secrets of the people's heart." I told him that I had been praying about this, that the people told me that it was of the devil, the ministry. He referred to me many scriptures, such as when Philip found Nathanael, and Nathanael came to Jesus. Well, Jesus told him where he had been, where he was under the tree when Nathanael found him. And many other scriptures, such as the woman at the well, how that she was revealed, her sins to her. When Jesus told her that she had five husbands, she ran into the city and said, "This is the Christ." Many other scriptures he referred to. I told him I would go. He gave me the assurance that he would be with me always.
So at this particular time, he took the people by the hand. Now in that meeting, I can't tell you what was preached, but there was one thing that would never, never leave my heart. And that was, in the prayer line that night came a small girl. She was about 10 years old. Rather full face, brown ringlets coming down to her shoulders, a very pretty little girl. Sitting so close as I was, it was easy for me to see that she was blind. So Brother Branham didn't have to discern her illness when he just looked at her, because her eyes, all you could see was the white of her eyes. And the pupils were crossed directly into her nose. You could just see very, very little of the pupils beside her nose. When he looked at her, he just began to pray for her. And I was overjoyed. I thought, "Oh, I'm going to see something for the first time," because so many of the people, they had heart trouble, they had cancer, they had something internally wrong with them, but now I was going to actually view something. So I waited with anticipation for this girl to be healed. He prayed once, nothing happened. He prayed twice, he looked at her, nothing happened. Three times, four times. About the fourth or fifth time that he prayed, my heart had sank. I thought, well, just like I had almost expected, the time I have the opportunity to see something, I'm up close and nothing is taking place. So my young heart became discouraged. He prayed six times and still nothing happened. And then he did something and prayed a prayer that I'll never forget. He just took and embraced her head to his bosom like this. And he first addressed the enemy, Satan. And he said, "Satan, God has ministered this gift to me by an angel. And the angel told me that nothing would stand before my prayers, not even cancer, if I could get the people to believe." He said, "The people are here, they are believing, and now I adjure you by the living God to let her go." At that moment, he just turned her around like this and had her facing the people. She was looking straight down where I could see her, straight down towards me. Her eyes were just as straight as mine are right now. Well, of course, the people just became ecstatic. People stood, cried out. There was just a sweep of praise and worship sweep throughout that entire crowd. And Brother Branham lifted up that child, and she looked around the building, because it was arena the lights were very bright, and she looked up at the lights, and her eyes watered. She was just as perfectly whole as she could be. Well, that miracle never left my heart. But I became aware that there was, it was not just a miracle, but God anchored something in my heart at that particular time. And then, from that time on, I knew that there was something very special about the ministry of Brother Branham. Then during the 1950s, I became a minister, began to minister about 1955, 1956. And I had become acquainted with many of the great ministries at that time. There was a proliferation of great ministries. They were gathering thousands of people into tents, auditoriums, and cities all across America, Canada, and even many other parts of the world. I would get their magazines, their circulars, and keep abreast of the times of what was happening. Of course, this was a gripping experience for a young man. But it was only a short time when I began to see some disturbing characteristics on the horizon. I saw a decline in some of the ministries. It seemed that some were going to go towards the more formal type of religion. Others seemed to be swayed by money and popularity. So I began to be very, very troubled. I was pastoring then a small church up in Dawson Creek, which is mile zero on the Alaska Highway. It's still in British Columbia, but it's where the Alaskan Highway commences, and I mention that here because it's very important in the rest of my testimony. I pastored this church for a total of 3.5 years. But it was while I was pastoring that church, a relative of mine who was a missionary to Cuba, so he journeyed back and forth through the eastern states. He made one of his trips back home. He was helping me for a short time on a home that I was building. And while we were working one day, he asked me if I had heard recently of some of the things which Brother William Branham was teaching. I said, no, I hadn't heard. I've had very little contact with the outside world, as it were. And he said, well, something strange, he said. Something about Cain being the son of the serpent. Well, I said, what? Where did he get that? And he said, he was very sincere, and he himself was troubled. So he said, I just don't know. And I said, my, I was so troubled myself. And so I didn't say any more, he didn't say any more, but that just sunk down in my heart like a real heavy weight, because I had always esteemed Brother Branham very, very much. And throughout the mid-1950s and up till this time, this was about 1958 when he was speaking to me, I knew the reality of the ministry, the phenomena, the spectacular, the accuracy of the ministry. So now when my relative and a dear brother of mine in the Lord told me of some doctrine that Brother Branham was preaching, that's the reason for the great heaviness which came into my heart. At that same time, because I was a minister, I had really three questions. The first and least troublesome was the baptism, water baptism. I wondered whether it should be in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, or should it be in the name of the Lord Jesus or the Lord Jesus Christ. I just wasn't clear. The second question was on the Godhead. I had very dear minister brethren who believed he was one. I had some dear brethren who believed he was three, And I had some who believed that there was only two. So I was very much confused. There seemed to be no place to have clarity on the subject. So I had wondered about that. And then when this relative of mine had told me of the serpent seed, I was very deeply troubled. So it was a short time after this, a man was saved in my church, and his name was Bud Southwick. He later became hunting guide to Brother Branham and myself. He was a dear friend of mine, but he came from the country way up from where we lived. He was a rancher at that time. Gave his heart to Christ. I remember him so vividly coming and kneeling, and his sons coming and kneeling in a row. He had five sons. They just knelt in a row beside him, and he surrendered his life to Christ. Well, because we were, I think, the only people in the town that he was close to, every time he came into the city to sell cattle or do some business, he would stay overnight at our place. One night while he was staying there, I had a visiting minister also speaking at the church. After the service, we were sitting in the front room speaking, and Brother Southwick began to tell me that the government of British Columbia was seeking to give him a hunting territory way far in the north, about, oh, it would be 350, 400 miles north of where we live.
Well, he said, you go back down, write me a letter, and post-date it back up 3 or 4 years. He said that you want to, if never, ever an area comes open up in this front part of the country, well, I want it. So that's what I done. He said, you can be ready to go hunting in spring, because it's yours. And we already had, you'd wrote to Brother Branham already to come hunting.
Yeah, I wrote to him, yeah.
And he was my first hunter.
Yeah.
And the whole business.
Yeah, he was the first one.
I hadn't even asked him there before. He just, out of the blue, that he sent word down there.
18 months went by, and I didn't hear a single thing. During that 18 months, I resigned the church, my pastorate there in Dawson Creek, and moved all the way south, around 850 miles, to Victoria. It was just 3 weeks after I moved to Victoria that I got a letter from Billy Paul Branham, that's Brother Branham's son, and he said that his father would very much like to come north and go for a rest and perhaps do some hunting in the spring. That would be May of 1961. So they suggested having 3 days meetings in Grand Prairie, Alberta, which was just 75 miles from Dawson Creek, and then 3 meetings in Dawson Creek. Then we would go immediately up north, up the Alaskan Highway, for a hunt. Once we had the meetings arranged, I met Brother Branham up in Grand Prairie. So I came to Billy Paul's motel unit, knocked on the door, and he greeted me. And he said, oh, Brother Biscoll, he said, Daddy's waiting to see you. So it was a double-decker type of motel. And so we went upstairs to Brother Branham's motel room, and Billy Paul knocked on the door. I heard his father say, come in. And Billy walked in just ahead of me, and he said, Daddy, Brother Biscoll's here to see you. I heard him say, oh, fine. He said, bring him in. So I just stepped in the door, and just as I stepped in the door, he was shocked to see that I was as young as I was. I was 27. He was expecting a man about 50. And he was sitting on the edge of the bed, and he just looked at me like this. Oh, he said, are you Brother Biscoll? I said, yes, I am. Why, I said, you're just a child. I said, well, that's me. That's all I am. That's all I can be. And he said, well, I was expecting a man perhaps about 50 or 52 years old. And I said, well, no, you know, I'm 27. So we sat down and we talked and got acquainted a wee bit. There was an Indian woman that came up with the chief from the Ucluelet tribe. The chief was actually acting as pastor for the tribe. I knew them very, very well. I stayed in their home many times. My wife and I stayed in their home. I had meetings for over 1 year in that tribe. And he brought a woman that had been given 2 weeks to live from cancer. 12 years later, I heard this story from the mouth of the woman whose home they stopped and stayed overnight before they left Vancouver Island. That woman, her name is Mrs. Dick. She's a Christian woman. She told me that woman was hemorrhaging so bad, they tore up bed sheets and laid under her. And she hemorrhaged so bad that night that she soaked everything and went into the mattress. She had had some experience in first aid nursing. She told this brother who was taking her, he said, she will not live to arrive up there to these meetings. But they were determined to take her, and she was determined to go. They drove in a 1948 Chev car, six of them, 800 miles, 850 miles. While they were in these meetings, Brother Branham, under that anointing of discernment, he was attracted to, and he pointed to a corner of the building. He said, there's an Indian woman. She's shadowed with death. It's cancer. He said, stand, the Lord has healed you. She was unable to stand, but that night, in the motel where they were staying, she was staying with a woman who we also knew very well, Mr. and Mrs. Albert Jackson. Late in the night, or in the wee hours of the morning, she became deathly ill. And Sister Jackson took her to the bathroom, and she passed a large cancer. And God healed her. 12 years later, when I heard the full account, she was still healthy and well. So you see, that was one of the outstanding things that took place in that meeting. Then we went to Dawson Creek. Well, now here, God really began to deal with my heart, because now I was amongst my people, people that I had pastored for 3.5 years. I had known them since I was just a child. While the people were gathering, I saw in the lobby the entry of this large hall. We had gotten the United Church Hall for the meetings. That was the largest place we could acquire or obtain. There was a U.S. soldier. I saw his tunic, and I saw the staff sergeant stripes on the side. Well, as a boy, I had spent quite a long time in U.S. Army camps. My father worked for them while they were building the Alaskan Highway. So a lot of memories passed through my mind. I thought, it's nice to see this soldier uniform, you see. But then that's all I saw of him. So here come this woman. Her name was Sister Clunt. She didn't live in that city. I knew where she lived. I had been to her place. Very, very familiar people to me. God did this, you see. It was a special thing he was doing. I believe he did it not only for her sake, but also for mine. So Brother Branham began to speak to her. He said, how do you do, sister? I suppose we're strangers. She acknowledged that. He said, I wouldn't have any way of knowing why you're here. And he just talked to her for a while like that, likened it to the woman at the well, and how Jesus revealed the very secrets of her heart, and she went away rejoicing. So I just was observing these things. And then he said, you're not here for yourself. You're praying for a man said, that man is shadowed by death. He's dying with cancer. While he said these things, she was acknowledging it. He said, the man does not live in this city. He said, he lives in a town just north from here. I believe the name of that town, he said, is Fort St. John. She said, that's right. He said, go your way and believe. I noticed he didn't say that the man was healed, but he said, go your way and believe. And just one thing after another was confirming and reconfirming this servant of God, not just a gift, but the vessel. Whenever he opened his mouth, he spoke the truth. This is what was registering so profoundly to my own heart. And then we came, I believe it was to the last service, either the second last or the last service. Brother Branham had come to the close of the meeting, finished preaching.
Do you love him with all your heart? All your heart, just raise your hands high and praise him. Say, thank you, Lord Jesus. What's the matter, soldier boy? You're not going to commit suicide. The devil's lying to you, boy. You've only got a phobia. He's lying to you. He'll drive you insane if you believe him. Deny him. Renounce the devil. I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to renounce the devil and accept Jesus Christ as your healer. You'll go back and be a gentleman and a real, real man.
I was stunned to have something so abruptly interrupt the beautiful, soft singing of that chorus, I Love Him. And everyone began to crane their necks and look around. And I, too, was looking for the soldier boy. I thought immediately, perhaps it's that one that was in the U.S. tunic uniform that I saw a couple days before. So the meeting just ended, and that's all there was to it. Early Monday morning, we got up about 5 o'clock. We got up about 4 and left the city about 5 o'clock. Began our journey up the Alaskan Highway. Now, no one knew, not even Brother Branham, exactly where I was going to take him. So, the town that's immediately north of Dawson Creek is Fort St. John. It's about 45 miles up the highway. When the U.S. Army built the road, and this is very important, they just carved it right out of the wilderness, you see. The town of Fort St. John was more or less the result of the building of the highway, you see. And then the farming country began to open up and so on. So when they carved the highway through just the homesteads and little farms, it cut right through a particular farmyard, leaving the farmhouse about 100 yards off to the right-hand side of the highway. Then, a short distance from there, the road turned into the town, and the town laid about a quarter of a mile up on the right-hand side. So, as we started Monday morning, of course, we were just feeling relaxed. We were in our blue denims, and another brother was along with us at Brother Branham's request, Brother Chris Berg, who both my wife and I knew ever since we were children. And so as we were driving up the road and just speaking freely and very relaxed now, Brother Branham, the pressure of the meetings was off his shoulders, and I was hoping that sometime I would get a chance to talk to him, but I was going to leave that until later on in the trip, if the Lord allowed a chance. So we're just driving up the road and we're starting to pass Fort St. John. Brother Branham said, there was a woman who came in the healing line praying for a man dying with cancer in Fort St. John. Oh, I said, Brother Branham, that woman was a very good friend of my mother and father's. I've known her ever since I was a little boy. Her name, I said, is Sister Clunt. And Brother Branham just went like this as we were driving now. He said, the man's in that house. And he pointed to that big white farmhouse that was so familiar to me, I had seen it many, many times. When we finally arrived to Brother Southwick's home, I should say to his camp where they were more or less camping right out in the total wilderness, and from his place then we would go hunting, you see. But when I arrived there, I told Brother Southwick what had happened on the platform in Dawson Creek when Sister Clunt came to him, and he told how this man was dying with cancer in Fort St. John. Then I said, as we drove past the town, he cried out and went, pointed his finger and said, the man's in that house, as we drove past. And Brother Southwick said, well, that's right. He said, I know that man. His name is Ed Thomas. I've known him ever since I was a small boy. And he said, I also know that he's dying with cancer. So you see what had happened now. I got it on the platform as we drove past on the highway, and now out of the mouth of my very dear friend. But now comes one of the most outstanding things. From Fort St. John, about another 250 miles, lays the next small town called Fort Nelson. So we arrived to Fort Nelson around noon. This is a wilderness town. There's just some motels and things built alongside the road. There was a small hotel, not a very old one, but just built out of wood, you know, a wood structure. And we parked in front of it, walked into the restaurant, sat down, just the three of us, Brother Branham, Chris Berg, and myself. The waitress came, we ordered our food, and just before our food had arrived, before our soup had arrived, the door of the restaurant opened, and in came a face that I recognized as being the young boy, the soldier boy, who I saw in the U.S. tunic back in Dawson Creek. And at that moment, there was a short, quite heavy-set, sandy-haired man. He squeezed between the soldier and our table and thrust his hand down to Brother Branham, and he said, Brother Branham! And Brother Branham was startled, and he put his hand up to shake hands with him. He said, oh, do I know you? No, no, he said, you don't know me. And now he was shaking his hand. You don't know me, he said, but do you remember calling out that soldier boy the other day? And Brother Branham was a little bit, you know, he was taken back. So he looked at me across the table. Brother Eddie, he said, do you remember? Yes, I said, I remember. You said, you're not going to commit suicide, soldier boy. That's the devil talking to you. This man still had Brother Branham's hand. He said, that's right, that's right. That's what you said, that's what you said. He said, this is him. And he said, Brother Branham, the army doctors put him in my custody. I drove him down from Fairbanks, Alaska, 1,500 miles to get him in the prayer line. He said, we couldn't get a prayer card. We couldn't get him in the line. But he said, I believed that I was going to find you today. And then the soldier spoke up for the first time. He said, that is the truth. So he said, Brother Branham, would you pray for him? Brother Branham said, sure, certainly. But he said, well, perhaps we'll just eat our meal and then we'll pray for him. So these two men said, that's fine, because we need to eat too, and we'll just have our dinner. So they went two booths up from us and sat down. Then Brother Branham looked at me and he said, you see, Brother Eddie, this young man now, probably if God doesn't do something special for him, there may be no hope for him. And I was lost for words. I could see now that the freedom with which Brother Branham was experiencing while we journeyed, now he became serious. He was becoming burdened. He was entering into this young man's need. Truly love projecting is what it was. So while he was eating soup, and I was eating directly across the table from him, he began to have visions. And he said, there was a woman, a blind woman was in the healing line yesterday. And then he just stopped a moment. He looked at me. He said, you see, Brother Eddie, it may be that this woman is praying just now. And he stopped a moment again, just a moment of silence. Yes, he said, she's a young German woman. She has heart trouble, gallstones, and a third ailment that I don't recall just at this time. He mentioned three main ailments which she was suffering from. Then he looked directly in my eyes. He said, do you believe, Brother Eddie? Oh, I was trying so hard to believe. I said, yes, Brother Branham, I do believe. He said, now just to help you believe, I'll ask him, and he'll give me her name. And he just stopped for a moment like this. Yes, he said, she's a young German woman. Her name is Sister Fair. He said, perhaps in English we would say fear, but in German it's fair. He stepped back a wee bit. He said, that's right. It was all over then. So he just continued to eat his soup like that. We finished our meal. And then, as soon as we were done our dinner, we moved to the cash desk, paid our bill. Just as Brother Branham was going out the door, this soldier was standing right behind him, and he took Brother Branham by the shoulder, and he had his hand on his shoulder, and he said, Brother Branham, just 2 minutes, just 2 minutes. Oh, yes, Brother Branham said, it'll be fine. So we just, all of us stepped out the door. Now, you must notice how the events unfolded now. As we stepped out, there was a small wooden sidewalk, and it went a short distance this way to where the vehicles were parked. Brother Branham and this tall soldier walked down there side by side and stood with their backs to us. Brother Chris Berg and this sandy-haired man came, and we stood together at the cars. And this is what he said. He said, the doctors can't determine what's wrong with him. He's tried to commit suicide 3 times in the last 14 months. He said he has a lovely Christian wife and 2 beautiful children. But he said, we can't figure out why he's trying to destroy himself. While he was talking, I kept watching down there. I wanted to see what was happening. I saw Brother Branham had taken his hat off, and he always held that little cowboy hat he wore over his heart. And his head was bowed, and they were praying. Then he slid that hat back on, and I was just watching, you see? And they both turned around and started coming back towards us. So I was just watching. But as the two of them came down, I had to admit immediately that that soldier's face, his whole countenance had completely changed. His face had relaxed. There was literally, without exaggeration, a glow upon his face. And as they walked down that sidewalk towards us, he thrust his arm in the air 3 times, and he just cried out. He said, I'm free! I'm free! I'm free! Well, I knew he was free. They walked up to us, and he said, only I and my wife in this world know what this man told me. And as soon as he did, he said, I was free. So we said our farewells. goodbye. They got in their vehicle, which incidentally was a 1939 Ford pickup. They drove their way on the way back up to Anchorage, or rather to Fairbanks, and we got in our car. Brother Branham was at the driver's at the wheel, driving. I was sitting in the passenger side. Brother Chris Berg was in the back seat. Brother Branham said to me, "Brother Eddie, do you know this young man?" I said, "No, Brother Branham, I don't." He said, "He's not a close friend of yours." "No, Brother Branham," I said, "we're strangers." Now, he said, "You understand, I'd never tell you," he said, "if he was a friend of yours. But just to help you believe, when we went to the end of the sidewalk, he came to us there. And I was familiar with that phrase. Told him he had a lovely Christian wife and two beautiful children, but he had been committing homosexual acts with young men. And this complex, he called it, had gripped him. But soon as that spirit was exposed, he was set free completely. I sat in that car and I just couldn't help but say to myself, I've just stepped out of the pages of the Bible. This is exactly what happened in the Bible. So then we journeyed from there on to up to Southwick's. Of course, this was the first time that Brother Bud and Sister Lila Southwick had opportunity to meet Brother Branham. Then, before we could go out on the pack trip, we had to go and round up the horses. And Brother Branham and I went off by ourselves one evening, and we were just walking down a narrow trail, but we were going side by side. So I began to ask Brother Branham, I said, "Brother Branham, how do these visions work? How do they come?" And he did something, one of the most unusual things, that one of the most memorable things to me. He reached out his arm and put it around my shoulder. He said, "Brother Eddie," he said, "I love you just like a son." He said, "If I could do anything to help you," he said, "I would." Now, he said, people don't understand these visions. They think that I just have the visions. But he said, I can't bring them on, and I can't stop them. He said, it's the people's faith. They believe. They're drawing on God, and God uses me to tell them that their prayer has been answered. Now, he said, you're a minister. You get anointed for preaching the word. He said, when that anointing is gone, you can't bring it back. I actually laughed. I said, Brother Branham, that's exactly the truth. And he said, it's an anointing, you get anointed to preach the word. He said, I get anointed to see visions. He said, all I can tell you is that I just yield. Well, he couldn't have said anything simpler, yet he couldn't have said anything more difficult. I really pondered that. I just yield. So I was gaining a little understanding, a little deeper understanding of his ministry. And then that night, we were around the supper table in Brother and Sister Southwick's. I'll never forget it. As soon as we had finished eating, we remained at the table, Brother and Sister Southwick, all their five sons, Brother Chris Berg, myself, and Brother Branham was sitting at the end of the table. He began to relate experiences and things which God had done through the years. The presence of God came so mightily. We sat there till 10 o'clock that night. No one moved. We were captivated. And then at a given moment, Brother Branham just straightened out like that. I was sitting on his left at that time. He said, "Brother Eddie," he said, "that pillar of fire isn't 2 feet from any one of us at this moment." I tell you, it was an electrifying experience.
He stood there in that cabin drying dishes for Lila and told her her whole life. He was talking about another woman, like, you know, some woman. And she never could figure it out, because she'd say to me a lot of times, you know, the things of what he told her through that. And then afterwards, it come to her as plain as day, it was her that he was telling what was going to happen, like this arthritis and the whole thing. He told her that whole thing. If she'd have known what she'd have seen what she was going to turn out.
Isn't that amazing?
Over the whole thing. She mentions that every few days yet, you know, how he told her. But she thought it was some other woman that he was talking about.
Then, I guess one of the most outstanding experiences of my life was to take place now in the next couple days. These questions in my heart were just building up. I was hoping I would have the chance to be just alone with Brother Branham for a short time. And it was the second day that we were actually hunting. Now, while we hunted, Brother Chris Berg and I would go either alone or our own separate ways, and Brother Branham would go with Brother Southwick. So this evening, we had just finished eating, and I was going to clean up in the camp and do the dishes and so on. That was really my duty. I went along to do some of the cooking, you see. That way I justified my presence. And Brother Branham said, "Brother Eddie, would you like to come along? I think I'll go and maybe see if we can get a prairie chicken or a rabbit for some camp meat." Of course, this is what I had been praying for. The two of us, we left the tent and we walked down. It was the perfect evening, just in the cool of the day. I wasn't interested in hunting, and I don't think Brother Branham was very interested in hunting. We walked, perhaps a mile, and talked all about the different things, you know. We came to a place where there was a large log sitting on this side of the trail, and we just walked over to the log, unprepared, unrehearsed, sat down. I began to pour out my heart. As a young minister, I said, "Brother Branham, how is it that men, ministers, they operate gifts, even have healings, gifts of wisdom and gifts of knowledge, discernment and various things, but I said, their lives are not right. Their lives are not correct. There's something wrong in their lives." And Brother Branham said, "Well, have you heard my message on, you know, false anointed ones?" And I said, "No, I hadn't." He said, "You know, Jesus said in the scriptures," I'd like you to notice that he said, right away he referred to the scriptures, "The rain falls on the just and the unjust." And I was trying to follow him. I said, "Yes." He said, "Also, on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit fell," he said, "notice what Peter said. Peter said, 'This is that which was spoken of by the prophet Joel. In the last days, saith God, I'll pour out my spirit upon all, A-L-L, flesh.'" Now, Brother Branham said, "All flesh is not saved, but the Holy Spirit would be poured out upon all flesh." Then he said, "Jesus also told the parable of the wheat and the tares. The same sunshine shone upon the wheat and the tares." He said, "The same rain fell upon the wheat and the tares. Now he said, if you tell me what the wheat enjoyed, what it rejoiced in, I can tell you what the tares rejoiced in. And then I begin to understand. He said, it is the genuine spirit of Christ. It is the Holy Ghost. Then he referred me immediately to Matthew 24, where Jesus was speaking to his disciples, and he said to them that in the last days there would be many false Christs. Notice now, many false Christs would arise and deceive many. And the love of many would wax cold, you see, because of what would be taught at that time. Now, he said, they didn't say Jesus's. They wouldn't rise up and say, I am a Jesus. But he said, Christ means anointed. So these men will rise up and say, I'm anointed. He said, and they are. The anointing is genuine. But the vessel has some ulterior motive, something's not correct, not right. And that's why this generation, this age, would be so deceptive. Well, all I can tell you is that there was 1,000 questions answered in my heart with that few moments we spent. And then came the great moment of my life. He said, Brother Eddie, this afternoon as I was riding on my horse, just behind Brother Bud, he said, I believe we were on this mountain. He pointed to a certain mountain. He said, it was, oh, lovely and warm. The sun was shining. He said, he came to me there. And I knew what he was saying then. He said, I believe you have 3 questions that you'd like to ask me. The first one is on the water baptism. The second one is on the Godhead. And the third one is on the serpent seed. It was as though my heart had been completely opened. I was naked. I was exposed. There was nothing hidden. I knew then what it was to be in the presence of God with nothing hidden, my heart like an open book. I looked then into his face, into his eyes, and it was different. It was different. It wasn't just the man that I hunted with. I knew indeed that this was God's prophet. And I said, that's true, Brother Branham. Those are the 3 questions. But I was so wound up inside, I was ready to explode. And this great problem, this great question I had on Cain and being not the seed of Abraham, or I'm sorry, not the seed of Cain, not being the seed of Adam. So I responded right away and I said, Brother Branham, but the scripture says in Genesis 4:1, and Adam knew his wife and she conceived and bare a son, called his name Cain, for she said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. Well, Brother Branham's answer blew me right almost off that log. He said, Brother Eddie, that's exactly the truth. I thought, what is he saying? This is my great defense, and now it has just been blown away. He said, but you need to read the next verse. Oh, I couldn't even remember what the next verse was. So he said, and she again bare his brother Abel. He said, they were twins. Well, I didn't get any great revelation. There was no great unveiling of the scriptures to me at that moment. But I knew I had missed something. That was what I came to understand. And then he just said to me, in the kindest way a person could possibly do so, he said, Brother Eddie, these things come by divine revelation. And what you want to do is just be real sincere and pray, and I'll pray for you as well. And I believe that he'll reveal it to you. That was about the end of our conversation. He didn't try to convince me about anything, but he just directed me immediately to the scriptures. And I can tell you from the very depths of my heart that in just the next short months after that, the scriptures began to open up to me. They were quickened, made alive. And I saw that these doctrines were absolutely the truth of God's word. In fact, they're not incidental doctrines. They are foundational doctrines of the scripture. And then there was one other instance, and I think that God has some humor to some of the things that he does. Brother Southwick, who was very well known to me, I had known him for many years. He used to like the odd cigarette, but do you know I never saw him smoke a cigarette in my life? And on this occasion, he got a real desire one day to go and have a cigarette. So
he was in the tent. We had a fire going outside because it was windy like this here, and I was scared of burning the tent, you know. So I had a fire going outside, and I said, well, I got to go down and check the hobbles on the horses. I wanted to get away and have a smoke. And so I went down over the hill and checked them to make out that I was checking them hobbles. You know, I had a cigarette. I come back up to the fire and I'm making tea there. And
outside? He, you're outside the
thing? I was outside making tea on the fire. And he was inside and he said, he hollered out of the tent. He never even looked out or nothing. He just said, Bud, did you ever smoke? And, yeah, I said. And he said, when did you quit? I said, I just quit.
Just this minute.
Yeah, just I.
One day, we were sitting on a mountainside. I can't adequately portray what the country is like. Vast hillsides, it's above timberline, alpine, just thousands of acres of grass and flowers. And they come up into shale slides and then into granite cliffs, peaks, magnificent. Streams, rivers, wide, wide, expansive valleys. And one day, the sun was just shining so beautiful and warm. Brother Branham and I, as we sat there, he said to me, you know, Brother Eddie? He said, over there, just beyond the curtain of time, it's very much like this. He had just had that experience, and he said, I saw millions of people over there. Brother Eddie, he said, I handled them. He said, it was so real, and yet I was not 20 or 25 feet from my body. He said, I had always wondered about what it was on the other side. And one day that angel stood there at his bedside and said, I have come to show you the things that you have inquired about, desired to know. And he said, in a moment, no sensation, no feeling, in an instant, he beheld millions of people. I was so impressed. He brought the reality of the other realm, the place to which we go, brought it so real. He told me that he bit his finger and he pinched his hand just to determine whether he was there in a literal way. But he said it was very, very real. And I'll never forget that. He looked down the valley that way, cast his glance up this way. He said, over there, Brother Eddie, it's just very much like this. He said, in one day, when you get over there, he said, you'll find some little trails. He said, you go on one of those. One day, he said, you'll find me. I'm counting on that. I really am. Then that fall, Brother Branham wanted to go out again because, you see, in the spring, you can only hunt bear. He loved the country so much. He told me it was just marvelous country, and he wanted to come back and bring Billy Paul with him, his son. So that fall, we arranged another hunt. But about a month before we went up there, I got a telephone call from him to my home in Victoria. And Brother Branham, during the telephone call, he said, "You know, Brother Eddie, I think we're going to have a fine hunt." He said, "I had a dream or a vision, I don't know which, but," he said, "in this dream or vision, I killed a large animal with its horns went directly up over its head. I never saw an animal like that." He said, "I'll tell you all about it when we meet in Dawson Creek about a month from now." So about a month later, we met. I still remember the name of the motel we stayed in. It was the Cedar Lodge Motel in Dawson Creek. My father was still living in that town at that time, fall of 1961. So I invited my dad to come down, and we sat together in the motel. I said to Brother Branham, "Brother Branham, why don't you tell the vision to my father?" So he told the vision in detail, and this is the details now. He said, "I was out hunting with two or three small fellows." He said, "One of them had a kind of a checkered shirt, a green checkered shirt." He said, and he said, we came to a place that was a great panoramic. And he swung his hands out like this. He said, "And there we spotted some giant animal with great horns coming back on its head like that." He said, "He was a dark chocolate brown animal." He said, I shot that animal. And he said, "After I'd shot that animal, then we were on our way back to meet my hunting buddy," he said, "who was in this green checkered shirt." He said, "It seemed as though we were journeying towards camp, and he was waiting there for us. And as we were on our way, we came upon this great giant grizzly bear." He said, "At that moment, I remember looking down, and I was carrying old Blondie," that was what he called his 270, a 270 Winchester, I believe it was. He said, "And it seemed that that gun got so very small while I looked at that bear." And he said, "But I remember I fired one shot and I killed that grizzly bear." And then he said, "When we came to where my hunting buddy was," he said, "one of these men took out something and began to measure these horns." He said, "There was a pair of hands. I saw one of the young fellows," he said. "I saw his hands like this." And he said, "When he was holding them like that, oh," he said, "there wasn't much hair on his hands. I would say he'd be about 18. Well, you see, I knew there was nobody 18 going on the hunt. Anyhow, he told the whole vision, and he said that this man, one of the small fellows, took something and measured these horns, and he said the vision, right at the end of the vision, he just heard a voice saying, "It's 42 inches. And the vision just passed off the scene then. Well, I was still quite gripped by the whole details, you see. So when we got to Brother Southwick's the following day, we arrived there just in time for supper. So we sat around the supper table, and we're just having a wonderful time of fellowship. And I said to Brother Branham, "Why don't you tell him the vision?" I did call it the vision. "Why don't you tell him the vision of that you had about the caribou?" So he began to give all the same details, you see. And when he got to this animal that was dark chocolate brown, I said, "But Brother Southwick," I said, caribou are not brown, they're steel gray. He said, you know, that's strange. Every caribou that we've ever shot on the north side of the highway has been a bush caribou, and they are just a battleship gray. He said, every caribou that we've got on the south side of the highway has been the mountain caribou. He said, and they're just a dark chocolate brown. Well, I had never seen a chocolate brown caribou in my life. And so I asked him right away, which side of the highway are we going to hunt on? He said, we're going on the south side, way up high into the mountains. So now you see, that lodged in my heart, dark chocolate brown animal. Then the next day, we're starting to get ready. And Blaine, his son, had been out on a pack trip, actually out on a survey crew, doing some survey work. I was surprised to see him at home. So I said to Brother Southwick, my, it's strange that Blaine got home, you know, so early from the survey crew. Yes, he said, he got home 2 days ago, and I guess he'll go along with us on the hunt. We'll make good use of him. So now you see, we were two or three small fellows. So Blaine was behind the barn. He was fixing a harness, pounding a rivet on a stone is what he was doing. I said, Blaine, how old are you now? He said, 18. Why are you asking? Oh, I said, I just wanted to know. So now, of course, the whole thing was zeroing in, you see. All we needed was the fellow with the green checkered shirt. I had had a green checkered shirt that I had wore for years. And it was wore out, so I had told my wife, please take that checkered shirt and destroy it. Just throw it away and go and get me a couple new ones. Well, the next day when we got up there, and the following morning was going to leave early in the morning on the hunt, I opened up my duffel bag, and there laying right there in my duffel bag is this checkered green shirt. I didn't think of the vision. I was distressed that my wife hadn't got me some new shirts. I saw that this one was all stitched up again here on the side. So I put that shirt on because it was a nice warm shirt, and away we went on the hunt. We ate our lunch, and then we walked up just a short distance to the top of a small ridge. We just arrived there, and there was a great panoramic. It fell away, swung, swept way out like this to the right, and laying over on a glacier across this great valley was three giant caribou. I'd never seen sets of horns like that in my life. It looked like they couldn't even hold them up with their head. It took Brother Bud and Brother Branham about 25 minutes to cross this valley and get over the ridge. We waited, Blaine and I, to see if he was going to get this animal. And sure enough, God gave him that beautiful animal. So then Bud had already instructed Blaine that he must take me and the horses back to where my meat was, load up the horses, and journey in a direction this way to a dry creek bed about 3 miles down, down this mountain ridge, and there we must wait. We waited for, I think, an hour, perhaps an hour and a half. And then Blaine said to me, he said, well, if they're not here in another 30 minutes, I'm going to go up and see what's happened to them. So another 30 minutes came by, and still no sign of his father or Brother Branham. So he left me and then went. Then, of course, here I was, waiting on the road towards camp, standing in a green checkered shirt. There's a caribou already been killed, you see. But there was no way for me to know that the vision was being fulfilled. I waited another half an hour, and then I heard some voices faintly. And here came Bud, Brother Branham, and Blaine. Bud was carrying this giant caribou head, as you know how their horns go up as I was describing. And I ran down this little knoll that I was standing up on, and I came up to Brother Branham, stretched out my hand and shook his hand. Oh, Brother Branham, I said, oh, that's such a lovely head, such a congratulations, I said. And he said, I got my bear, too. And, of course, I thought he was just, you know, joking with me. And I tapped him on the shoulder like that. I said, oh, I said, I don't believe that. He said, yeah, I did, I did. I said, really? I said, where is it? And Bud said, well, he said, you couldn't expect us to carry it. The hide weighs 300 pounds.
Oh, yeah, we spotted the bear. We went back up about a mile before we got up anywhere near close at all. But everything that he said, dog, come to pass there. And I never thought, you know, right at the time about it. And crawling up through there, and he had to wait. He laid down in the bush there for a while because he was sick. And then he got up and went some more. And when we got as far as we could get there without running out of bush, well, I had no idea he would, you know, shoot at that bear at that distance. And I said, boy, we can't get no farther. And we was under him to boot.
And he was still up the mountain?
Still up the mountain, yeah. Way up there, and just was way out of range to my notion. But, so I said, we'd have to go back and wait till tomorrow and go around the mountain, come in the other way. Because it'd be dark for whoever get around there that way. Oh, he said, I can hit him from here. So, man, I missed him. And he said, well, I shoot him. Well, he was facing us, that grizzly. Well, I shoot him, I'd be lucky if he hit the side of the mountain up there.
Right.
Where was it? Well, I said, shoot him right in the chest, and if you miss his heart, it'll break his back.
Mm-hmm.
And probably get them both. So that's exactly where he shot him. He shot him right up through and hit him in the heart.
And then I begin to feel just real strange. I said, well, you know, where is he? Well, he said, we left him up there. I said, you really got a grizzly? Yeah, Brother Bram said, got him, Brother Eddie. Got him. One shot.
And then down he come. Boy, he was coming too, I'll tell you. There was no trees big enough to get up for. And nothing. And I said, shoot that thing again. I don't hear my laugh. And he pulled up and the gun just snapped.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, my hair stood straight on him.
Because he was coming right towards you, wasn't he?
Yeah, he piled up dead and fired me over that tree over there.
Well, then, the whole thing, my mind couldn't work fast enough. And I was captivated by the events which were just happening, too captivated to really piece all the pieces together. And then I looked, and here Brother Bud had taken a small measuring tape out of his pocket or saddlebag, and he started to measure these horns. And he started them just where the horns come out from the head. There's a little ridge. You can give a very accurate measurement on the horns. There's a little ridge at the base of the horns. So he put the steel tape, hooked it on there, and began to draw the tape up through the curve as the caribou horns do, and then over at the top. You must take it to the last point, and that is the official measurement. Well, I was quite amazed because I had never seen a hunter carry a measuring tape before. So as he was pulling the tape up in the measurement, the tape slipped out at the bottom. So he started it again, and it slipped out again. Blaine was standing there, I was standing here, Brother Branham was standing directly on my right shoulder. And so Bud said to Blaine, hold that tape in there. So Blaine, here he is, 18 years old, me standing there in a green checkered shirt, him kneeling down, getting the tape in there, spreading his hands out like that, holding the tape in place, 18-year-old hands. And then Bud brought the tape over the end. Blaine reached up to have a look. I bent over to have a look. All of our heads came in at once, and Bud said, it's 42 inches. And the black line at 42 inches fell right on the end of the point of the horn.
That's when it hit me, is when I measured them horns, and they're exactly what he said. Well, then everything seemed to come back to me then, and when I even pulled that tape up there to that exact 42 inches, what he said, well, I just jerked my hand off that thing like it was hot.
I know. It was just like an explosion at that place, you know.
At that moment, it was like we were caught in the vortex of something culminating. It was the climactic moment, you see. And Brother Branham, he was standing perfectly erect. He reeled back slightly like that, put his hand forward with his finger, and just touched me on the back of my arm. He said, there it is, like that. There was such divine presence and an anointing. I'll never forget that moment. And then, on another occasion, it was, I believe the following fall. Yes, it was the following fall, when we went in the same area, but just a little bit further. And on this particular occasion, there was an Indian by the name of Oscar and Blaine Southwick, Brother Branham and myself. We went up a certain mountain valley, and it's a day that I'll always remember, because that day we stopped for noon to have a little bite of lunch. We made a fire, and we decided to start taking pictures of each other, and it was that day I was able to take what I have been told is Brother Branham's favorite picture of himself. I have it here. I think it best portrays him sitting in front of the campfire, just squatting, wearing, must be his favorite hat, seemed to be always wearing that, in a country that he loved very, very much. There on that fire, we made some tea and toasted our sandwiches. I think that depicts the kind of man he was, a rugged man, a man of the wilderness, in the surroundings of purity. The air is pure, the water is pure, the country is pure, and God's servant with a pure message to send to us. I sent Brother Branham a copy of that picture. I signed it from your buddy in the green shirt. It was this evening, the evening after this picture was taken, that we found ourselves too far from camp to return. So we decided we would sleep out in the open. And at this time of the year, it was getting just plenty cold. So Blaine and this Oscar, they took some of the horse blankets. They didn't smell too good. And they crawled under these horse blankets and to get some warmth and to get some sleep. Brother Branham and I decided there was only two trees, because we were actually above timberline, and there was these two fir trees, or balsam trees, I believe they were. So we chose the other one, and we would kind of protect ourselves under the branches. We built a fire, and it was a spectacular evening, I should say a night. We sat and we talked till way to the late hours, into the wee hours of the morning. It was only about two or three days after this. I had to leave all the rest of the men in the party because the demands of my work, I was working at that time, required that I return home and for my job. I felt very, very bad. I felt hurt. I wanted so badly to remain with them, but the real purpose that for my desire to remain, I had two great burdens in my heart. One concerned a sister of mine, and the other concerned a church that I'd pastored in Dawson Creek which a particular denomination was making every effort to seize control of the church and the property of which I had spent and labored much time and built up that work. In fact, the church building itself was largely built, and we were worshiping in it before I had left. So I wanted to speak to Brother Branham about these two things, but the opportunity never presented itself. And then I had to go. My ride was 30 miles alone on a horse in grizzly infested wilderness. I had to cross rivers and whatever more, not knowing the way out. So Bud, you know, he's a man of the wilderness. He said, well, the horse, he knows the way out. Just, you know, stay on the horse and he'll make his way. Wasn't much comfort to me. In the morning, the next morning was when I had to start out early. Well, when we woke up, there was great snowflakes like that. Just big, soft snowflakes falling. I thought, my, what a day. Cold, miserable, and here's the day I have to ride out, leaving Brother Branham. Great burdens on my heart, no way, no time, a job demanding that I come home. Oh, I felt so cheated. So I went into the tent where Brother Branham, Brother Fred Sothman, and myself were sleeping in this particular tent. I went in there alone, as all the men were in the cook tent having had breakfast. I began to roll up my sleeping bag. While I was rolling my sleeping bag up, the tent flaps just opened, and here came Brother Branham crawling in on his hands and knees. He said, well, Brother Eddie, sure hate to see you go. I had to actually bite my lip. Yeah, I said, I hate to go too, Brother Branham. I just hate to go. Oh, he sat back, he squatted, he folded his feet like this. It'd be really nice if you could just stay a while and, oh, maybe a month we'd stay up here and we'd go way up into some valley here, find a nice big, some big rams. I said, oh, Brother Branham. I was saying inwardly, don't do this to me. It was just like I was being tortured. I wanted to stay so badly, and he was kind of, you know, just off into a dream world about how nice it would be if we could stay up there a long time. But then he turned serious and he said, but I understand. I know how you have to work and you have a family to support. I understand those things. He said, and I understand about your sister and about the church in Dawson Creek. Well, I tell you, my heart just melted. I thought, oh God, you did remember me. You did, you've reminded me once again. Here I wanted to ask, but all you had to do was just remind me that you are aware. And it seemed that that was sufficient, and I should say that church never was swept into the hands of that denomination. God protected it from that. Another experience which I think is very outstanding, because it's one of those experiences that keeps being confirmed and reconfirmed again and again down through my life. It was shortly after the meetings in Vernon in 1949. I was in another service when Brother Branham prophesied that a boy would be raised from the dead. Now, in relating the vision, he said that this boy was not from America because of the way he was dressed. He said that his pants are tight just below the knees. He's kind of dark, curly-haired, and full face. He said that he's been killed and would be raised from the dead.
Well, I told everybody about it, prophesied throughout the United States and Canada. Thousands of Bibles had it written on their flyleaf that this would take place.
He also told the people to take their Bibles and write it in the flyleaf of their Bible. because he said, if this does not happen, you write false prophet across my back and never hear another word that I've said. Well, you just don't hear ministers or men saying those kind of things. So that certainly registered in my young and tender heart. I knew that this was not the average minister. This was not something that just anybody says lightly.
One day while we were having campaigns in the Scandinavian country, we were coming down through Finland from Kuopio, and there was a group of people gathered on the side of the road. They were hovered over some sort of a farm. We got out to look. There it was, the little boy.
The ambulance had taken the other boy to the hospital. So they pulled the sheet back, and Brother Branham looked at the boy. He said his heart was saddened because he thought right away, some daddy, some father is going to find out tonight that his son has been killed.
Everything just seemed just the way it was shown to me. I said to Brother Moore, look at your Bible and see if this isn't the scene. Yes, he said. I knelt down and asked our Lord Jesus to confirm his word that he had showed me and had told me would come to pass. The little boy was brought to life again by our Lord Jesus. He's alive and healthy today.
And then Brother Branham told me about the mother of the other boy because he was critically ill. They didn't know if he was going to live. So he told me that each night she would be there waiting for him, waiting to get his attention, to lay a hold of him, to please raise my son up as well. He explained to her, he tried to tell her that it wasn't him who did it, it was the Lord Jesus Christ. Then he said one day he was just standing in his hotel looking out the window. He saw a vision of a flower vase. He related this vision to me. And in the vase was two lilies. One was standing perfectly up and erect like this, and the other one was drooped right over the side, down like that. While he stood there looking, he said the lily that was hanging down over the side just turned, straightened right up, and the two of them stood perfectly erect in the vase. He spoke to some of his people and said, get the woman, because then he had a word from the Lord for her. He could give her, thus saith the Lord, her son would also be raised up. Well, it was many years after that, about 1979, that we were in Finland. And I was inquiring about this a boy that had been raised from the dead. Had there been any word? Did anybody hear of him? Yes, they told me. He's alive. He's well. He's a policeman working on in the traffic department just outside of Helsinki. However, a most unusual thing happened. After that, I know the pastor who is in Helsinki. His name is Matti Honkanen. A woman from his assembly was visiting in a senior citizen's home. While she was there, there was another woman who I believe was also visiting in the senior citizen's home. And when they saw each other, it seemed that they recognized one another, but it was from many years ago. In fact, it turned out to be 35 years since they had seen one another. So as they exchanged stories and where they're living and what they're doing, and they're both Christian women, so the one sister said, well, I go to a little assembly, a church, and we fellowship around the ministry and message which God sent by a prophet, Brother William Branham. Oh, this lady said, do you remember when Brother Branham was here in Finland? Oh, yes, this lady said, I remember. She said, do you remember about the boy that was raised from the dead, the one that was killed and was raised when Brother Branham was here? Oh, yes. The other one said, I remember that very well. And then this woman said, it was my husband that was driving the car that struck the bicycle that killed the boy. Many times, she said, my husband, who has now passed away, picked,
told me how Brother Branham picked the boy up in his arms and prayed for him. God give him life again. Now, I think that's a remarkable story, that it's a remarkable part of my life, that I was able to sit in a meeting to hear the account of the vision 2 years before it happened, then hear that it was fulfilled, then when I became, many years later, traveling overseas in ministry to meet people who have made this kind of contact.
Now we are these strangers. I see that you are strictly a stranger to me. You're from away from here. You come from another city. You've got a lot of trouble on your heart. You got hard trouble to begin with. Is that right? There's a whole lot of blackness. I see a black sheep keep following you like that. Oh, it's a lie. Somebody's told a lie on you. And that was a man who was professing divine healing.
Yes, sir.
He said you was a witch. Is that true? And you got a whole stir in your church or something or other about it. Isn't that right? Your pastor's sick right now. He's got polio. Is that right? Sister, don't pay no attention to what them people tell you. They're lying. And the only thing wrong with your heart is that nervous condition got your heart worked up. Go on home in peace, and God bless you. You're all right. God bless you. You're not all right. Come, lady. Almighty God, author of life, give this woman her perfect health in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. God bless you. Just a minute. Something happened to you. You know that. You're aware of that. Is that right? Why, it's all over the building. And every person here could be healed right now if you'd believe it. You believe this? Have faith in God. Amen. How many of the rest of you want to accept your healing? Jesus Christ is right here now to heal you. Do you believe that?
There was another most outstanding, and perhaps, I guess I would have to say, an experience which has never been duplicated in my lifetime, not in my ministry. I've been in great meetings. I've been in places where I have felt mightily the presence of God and the power of God. But this was unlike any experience I have ever had in my life. It was after this particular hunt was finished. I had wanted to get meat, but I didn't have any luck. So driving home, we were on the Alaska Highway. We were coming near to mile 177. And Brother Branham asked me a question. He said, "Brother Eddie, do you think that this ministry could be that of Elijah the prophet as it spoke of in the scripture in Revelation and so on?" And I noticed then that his voice began to trail off, as it did so often when he was under that particular anointing on the platform, ministering to the people, revealing the secrets of their hearts. Often his voice would just trail. When he asked me that question, did I think it was Elijah the prophet? Notice now, he didn't say my ministry. He said this ministry. Well, immediately, I felt so inadequate to answer the question, I just looked down towards the glove box of the car. I said, "Well, Brother Branham, for all that I know," I said, it must be. It has every appearance of being that. He said, "I often kind of wondered. I kind of think so myself." It was at that moment there was a presence. It was that pillar of fire that came. It was like a wind, yet there was no sound. It was just, it was instantly, I could even describe exactly, precisely where. It was a being. It was the person of the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ in the form of the Holy Spirit, right between us and slightly forward. I was literally frozen. And the thought and feeling that passed through my mind at that moment was, my next breath
will pass me directly into eternity. I thought if I moved, I would just pass away into some other realm. I didn't know what to do. It was fearful, and yet I wasn't afraid. It was, I think the best word I could use to describe it was awesome. Just awesome. I cast my eyes sideways. I didn't know what else to do but to look at Brother Branham to see what he was going to do. And I saw that his face had just turned ashen. We had been hunting about 10 days, and we had about 10 days beard on because we hadn't shaved. And I noticed also that his beard stuck directly out. The thought passed through my mind, he looks like a man that's very near to death. Brother Branham, his head just tilted back slowly, rolled slightly to the side. Then he cast those deep-set eyes across at me. He said these words, "Brother Eddie, I guess he's come to me 10,000 times 10,000. It's every time the same. It's just like I could die." At that moment, as we were driving, there was a great big moose, and I was needing one, standing right in the middle of the highway as we were turning the curve this way. That startled me. So quickly I responded, I said, "Oh, Brother Branham," I said, "stop, stop, there's a moose." And his voice was still very slow. He said, "It's all right, Brother Eddie. Just get your gun, your shells, and you'll get him." I said, "All right, Brother Branham, now you can stop." Because I had gotten my shell and my gun in my hand, "I'll take him now." He said, it's all right, Brother Eddie. You have him. He's yours." And he kept driving without slowing down. He's coming right up on the animal, maybe 200 yards now. I said, "All right, Brother Branham," because it was an easy shot now. "All right, Brother Branham, I'll take him. Just stop." He said, "It's all right, Brother Eddie. You'll get him." And he drove up, stopping 75 feet before that moose, not over 90 feet. We did pace it. I just don't recall whether it was 75 or 90 feet from that moose. I stepped out of the car. The moose never moved a leg. And when I put the rifle up that time to take him, it was the first and only time in my life that I could not make out the form of the animal. All there was hair as I looked through the scope. I had to move the scope up a little bit, and then I got the back line, brought it down, pulled the trigger, and a lot of thoughts were going through my mind. I was hoping he wouldn't drop on the highway, because that would be dangerous for an oncoming car. I was hoping he wouldn't drop in the ditch, because we didn't have room for him in the station wagon, and someone would steal him, perhaps. So he walked off the highway, across the clearing, into some trees, and there he fell, perfectly hidden, perfectly disguised. So we went over there, dressed out the meat as a very fine young animal, and in about two and a half hours we had finished. We came back to the car, sat in the car, got ready to go. Then there was the sweetest presence of Christ in the car. I said to as I sat there, Brother Branham just turned to me and he said, "You know, Brother Eddie, every time he comes, something good happens." I've kept that as a motto. Every time he comes, something good happens. Another time he came, and that was the very next year. My wife's father was struck down with a heart attack, a very severe heart attack. He hung between life and death for 5 weeks in an oxygen tent. We had had some meetings in Port Alberni. It was after these meetings, which My father-in-law had been hanging in the balances on a very, very fragile thread between life and death. I had wanted to speak to Brother Branham, but he was so occupied with the meetings. My wife had wanted to speak to him as well. We were saying our final farewell to him as he was leaving the motel in Victoria. And it was evening time. My wife was standing off to my right, about 5 or 6 feet. And I was saying just some light farewells. Well, Brother Branham, perhaps we'll see you this fall again when we go up north for a rest and hunt. Do have a good journey. And he was saying the same, look after yourself. And we were just shaking hands, some of those kind words one to another. And he stopped right in the middle of them, put his finger up, turned to my wife and said, by the way, Sister Biscoe, your father will be all right. Well, my father-in-law lived for 18 years from that day, and he was 66 years old at that time. 18 years, he worked, he drove, he lived completely free of any heart trouble from that time on. He died when he was 84 years old, without any pain. He just simply went to sleep, and the Lord took him. So we were indeed thrilled with that. And then in 1965, that was the year that God took Brother Branham from the scene and finished his work. It was Easter of 1965. I went to Jeffersonville for the meetings there. I was standing outside because the building had such an overflow crowd, we couldn't get near the building. And as I was just waiting there in the crowd for the service to begin, and then the song service began, and I felt a little nudge on my arm. It was Brother Doc Branham, and he said, oh, Brother Eddie, Brother Branham would like to see you. He said, just come with me. So I hurried with him and followed him around to the back, and they had just brought Brother Branham there to have the to bring the sermon or the message for the day. We came through the one room and then into his little study, and he said, oh, Brother Eddie, it's so nice to see you. And he greeted me, and I sat in a chair, and he pulled the chair up close, and we just sat directly opposite one another, our knees actually touching. And he took both of my hands in his hands like this. He said, well, so nice to see you again. And I said, well, you know, Brother Branham, that's how I feel. I'm so happy to be here. He said, you know, Brother Eddie, he put his head back a little bit like this. He said, every time I see you, I see Indians. It just wrenched the heart out of me because I had such a desire to somehow bring this message back to the Indian people, and not knowing how God would open the door, because I was so occupied. I was working, yet even though while I was ministering, I was supporting myself. And then I heard them start to sing, Only Believe, Only Believe. And he said, well, he said, that's my cue. He said, I want you to sit here, he said. And he stepped up out of his chair. I want you to sit here in my chair, he said, just so you'll be nice and comfortable, Brother Eddie, and you'll hear the message real good. I want you to hear the message. Well, I was almost fearful. I said, oh, no, Brother Branham, I'll go outside with, you know, where I was. And, no, he said, I want you to sit here. I want you to stay here. You just sit here. I'd like you to be real comfortable. And you can hear real well. The door's open here, because the door led directly onto the platform, you see. So it was one of my fondest moments. I sat in Brother Branham's chair, and he was preaching, It is the rising of the sun. And truly I can say, it has been the rising of the sun. The Son of God shone a brilliant light in our day, which has transformed my life, my ministry, And I am indebted to a faithful prophet and servant of God, to our Lord Jesus Christ, who sent him with this word for us in this generation.